All right, so we're up here on the deck of Windsong, continuing the tour of the boat, showing you guys what I've done, what I have left to do, and just thoughts on what's going on around here. You can see my lovely assistant, Coda, down there, helping me out for the day. Over on the side of the boat, you can see some fiberglass rings as I'm continuing my blister patch project on the bottom, as you saw in the last video. But enough of that. Up here on the deck now. As you guys have known, that the deck used to be in pretty rough shape. Lots of cracks and dings. This problem, that problem. Anyways, I came to the point where I realized I needed to completely refurbish it. So I did just that. I filled in and repaired all the dings, did a bunch of fiberglass work, and applied a system of paint called Interlux Perfection, where you see it's white. And it was a big project, which I wrote about on the blog, which you could see. But now the paint's about 2 years old and it's still holding up strong. I'm pretty happy about it, with a few exceptions, but most of them are actually my fault. Over the time, I've mistakenly used some abrasive pads to clean the decks, and it's caused the shine to go away a little bit over time, but it's still pretty protected. The issue is, as I'm sitting here in the boatyard, boats come next to me, get their bottoms or tops sanded down, and all the dust collapses on top of my boat. So if it's black bottom paint, it'll show up in the little tiny microscopic grooves I've carved into the paint due to the abrasive pads. So I've learned that lesson, and I hope to teach others. If you paint your deck with All Grip or Interlux Perfection or something like that, be sure you use the right tool to clean it. Otherwise, you can be facing some consequences. I struggled with deciding if I was going to put another coat of paint on or something to mask up all that damage I did, but I realized over time it really isn't that bad. And, you know, at this angle, it probably looks just fine, albeit a little dirty. So the paint's holding up, and I think it'll be all right. Up here at the front of the boat, you can see I've installed the bowsprit. It was a big issue of a project because, for one, this thing is a massive, heavy, solid piece of wood. So getting it up on here and taking it off and putting it back on and maneuvering it up here to position into place and so on was not easy, but with some help, I got it done over a few weekends. I had some issues trying to find the exact spot it was positioned in before. I realized after a while that I could just fit on the bow pulpit and align it with the holes on the rails, and I eventually solved that problem. But I got it installed, I'm pretty excited. You can see I've got some plugs I still have to sand down, because that's just some nasty epoxy and a teak bung to seal up the holes where the threaded rod goes through the deck. You can see up there it's my old manual windlass that I'll be installing on it soon. So that was a big pain in the butt project. I'm glad it's on. The pulpit I still actually have to bed and install. It's just kind of sitting there right now, but that pretty much completes the front of the boat. You can see here I have these holes where the hawse pipes go through. These are bronze hawse pipes that I removed from the boat that I still have to install. Unfortunately, I lost one over time, so I'm either going to have to get one custom made or continue my treasure hunt to find one that matches, which has been a failure so far. So we'll see. If anybody knows where these Downeasters had their hawse pipes made, please contact me. I'm kind of in desperate need of that source. Moving up front, you can see my hatches that I've all rebuilt. I've written about those. They're still holding up well, no leaks, and aside from dirt and grime that gets on them, they're beautiful all the time. You'll notice that I have painted on the non-skid paint. I used Kiwi Grip, which is this yogurt-like consistency paint that you roll on with a special roller to create a non-skid, like so. And it's pretty aggressive. You can actually dial it in less aggressive, but I made it pretty rough up here, particularly on the foredeck where you don't want to slip. Much like the white paint, over time it's gotten kind of ruined almost, because mostly because I've been installing things on deck, working with epoxy, and just crap gets all over it. And you can see these stains, just, you know, it looks kind of gross after a while. And all of that's permanent, just that's some polysulfide, epoxy, and God knows what. So before I splash the boat and finish it all up, I'll probably add another thin layer of the product just to make an even color over the spots. But I'm pretty happy with it. It feels a lot less dangerous up here with the non-skid on. I don't really worry about slipping and falling off the boat, which was a big issue before, particularly because I don't have my lifelines on yet. You can see I've installed the stern pulpit too, and once I get the bow pulpit on solid, I'll be installing the stanchions and lifelines, which will make it quite a bit more safe up here, which will be nice. Here on the other side, you can see I've installed a solar vent above the head. This is to replace a Dorad vent, which was there before. I wanted an active vent because I'll be using a composting head that I'll probably attach the exhaust hose to that vent. You can see I've started to install random things, cleats, deck fill, handrails up at the front. I still have to install, the rear. I still have to install the front handrails. But most deck hardware is on. Those hawse pipes, the main sheet cleats and winch, and just a few other things are all that's left to install on the deck. And on the rails, I still have to install the chain plates and, of course, the stanchions and lifelines like I just talked about. But the decks are getting there. They're mostly, I'd say, 80% of the way complete, ready to accept a mast and rigging. You can see over here that I've installed my small windows. I used Newfound Metals Tri-Matrix ports, which I'm pretty happy with. They aren't the solid stainless steel ports that a lot of people like, but I had to buy 6 of them, and those got kind of expensive, and these seem like an adequate alternative. They seem solid, and I'm pretty happy about them. Again, here's the one of the ports closer up at a better angle. You can see it's got this UV treated plastic and some stainless steel hardware. They open up and they're tinted, and they're not too bad. You can see up there, my big windows are still holding up strong. I've not had any issues with them leaking or coming apart, so that's good. They seem solid, albeit a little dirty just like everything else, but I'm very happy with that window job, and I've written about that. If you wanted to catch up on it, you just see some back posts. You can see here probably a good example of the kind of discoloration and grime that gets into the white paint. I hope that's in focus, it's hard to tell. And that's just dirt that can be scrubbed away, but it can now only really be scrubbed away with the harder, with like a more abrasive pad. And yeah, it just kind of gets gross in those channels. But that's what all the dirt and grime and daily dew and rain drain through, so I can't really fault it for getting dirty. Coming back here in the cockpit, see, this is where I'll be installing the main sheet winch. Those are the holes that are now filled with epoxy and ready to be re-drilled. And that's the main sheet cleat, which is ready to be installed. You can see I have an inner layer and an outer ring of holes there, and it's because I've upgraded from a pretty small Lumar number 8 winch to a big self-tailing Lumar number 40 winch. I remember when I sailed the boat around Florida, I had a lot of issues when the wind came up pulling in the main sheet. So I figured upgrading to a good winch would help that. And it didn't hurt that I found the thing brand new on eBay, just not in a box, for about half the price of a brand new one anywhere else. So keep your eyes open for deals like that, and you might find a good treasure, even though that wasn't cheap. Half off either. So you can see, just random things have been installed on the decks. These are winch bases and winch cleats, or jib sheet line cleats, drains, fill pipes, propane locker, cockpit lockers. You can see these gross vents back here, which were pretty bad to begin with, and I repainted them with this Rust-Oleum made for plastic spray paint, which only served to deteriorate really quickly in the sun, so I'll have to repaint them with something better or replace them, but hopefully I can keep them. I've completely refurbished my pedestal here and recently installed it. It received a brand new paint job of Interlux Perfection, and I greased up all the moving parts and cleaned them all out and got it all nice and pretty and ready to roll with the refurbished boat. So that was a bit of a job. Since it was aluminum, I stripped it all down bare and basically used it as a test run to figure out my painting system for the mast, and I think it worked out quite well. On top of the post here goes the compass, which is bolted in right here between these two. I've got the compass completely restored. I polished up the outside to look like brass again, and I've got the actual compass rebuilt from a professional, because I mistakenly opened it up and let all the fluid inside the compass spill out and pretty much broke the thing for good. But I saved all the pieces and was able to have it restored to almost a completely new state. So I'm excited to have that nice fresh compass. And if you've ever looked at how much these things cost new, it's pretty nuts. I was able to restore it to pretty much brand new for about a third of the cost of a new one, and it wasn't cheap even then. You can see here in the cockpit, there used to be all sorts of different things here. Right here was a big hole that contained the old autopilot controls. I didn't need that anymore, as I plan on going with the wind vane, and if I use a different autopilot, I probably wouldn't cut a big hole in the side of the boat to put the controls in. So I closed that up. I repainted the engine control panel dealy over here and reinstalled it, and I added this nice little plexiglass gasketed panel. I didn't screw it on right, obviously, because there's this gap, but I'll probably put a lock on there anyways to get it tight. But that's just to keep the water out, because water was getting in there pretty badly before. I've got cockpit drains installed. This is the cover plate for the manual bilge pump. The pump's not installed yet, and this is upside down from what it should be, so it's just there to keep the water out right now and before I come back and fix it. You can see right there I've got the shore power inlet area. I'm still not sure if I want to keep it right there, because putting the shore power inlet right there creates a really long run to where the AC breaker is, and through my research I've figured out that it's not wise to have a very long run from the shore power to the AC breaker. So I may move it somewhere like right there in the cockpit, where there used to be some sort of telephone line input that I've closed up. There was a hole right there that no longer exists, and that would cut down the run of line significantly, so I still have to ponder that and when I get to the electrical system work, I'll finalize that decision. So back here in the cockpit lockers, I've done a good bit of work. It was pretty nasty in here, and I've completely repainted and cleaned it. You can see under here the backing plates for my deck fixtures. This is for a cleat. I used 1/4-inch aluminum for a lot of these backing plates. Some of them I used about a 1/2-inch thick layered epoxy and fiberglass, which worked really well. You can buy that stuff in sheets, but it's pretty darn expensive. And I had a lot of fiberglass, so I chose to make them. So there's the stuffing box for the rudder, which I've repacked and made all fresh and leak-free, at least hopefully. And the steering column, which I've removed and experimented with, figuring out how to assemble and reassemble. I've cleaned it. It's pretty much all ready for the steering cables to be installed. So yeah, fresh new cockpit lockers. I rebuilt the bases that go right here to create the second level. They just aren't here right now. They're sitting in my garage, all painted and ready to roll. So the only thing I really have to do back here is to install the actual steering cables, which is part of the engine room as well, and then install the through holes that stick out back here. That's the engine exhaust, 2 bilge pump through holes. I've got that hole right there with the hose. That's the propane locker drain, and another bilge pump through hole. So a few things to do back here, but not much. Lastly, I'll just talk about the cap rail for a minute. You can see here the T cap rail. If you recall, I installed them and used some teak sealer, Simco teak oil sealer. And I like the idea of it because after about a year it just fades away. You can see it's mostly all gone now, and with a little bit of sanding, the rail is basically a fresh piece of wood again. You can see on the hatches, the Cetol, I use Cetol natural teak with the gloss Cetol to seal it up, and they've survived about a year out here and they look really good still and still strong. I may sand down these rails and the cap rail and the handrails and apply some Cetol to it to match the hatches, because I really like the product. But I also really like the option of not having to recoat the Cetol on this long rail. So we'll see. I just gotta make that decision. Alright, so that's the deck. As you can see, it's getting there. Mostly done. Just a few things to install before I can get the mast and rigging on. Probably gonna recoat that Kiwi grip just because it's gotten ugly over time with all the construction up here. And that's it, and I'll see you guys next time where I take you on the tour of the inside. So long.